What's up, bros, and welcome to another BroGraph Brocast. I'm Dave.
And I'm Matt, and we have a special guest today, a good friend of ours and excellent graphic designer, 3D motion graphics extraordinaire, director, writer, basically all of the above, podcaster, video game designer, successful Kickstarter, Sean McCoy.
Hey, how's it going?
It's good.
Good.
That's all you got for me after that amazing introduction?
I am what I am, as Popeye said.
So, Sean, you're a contractor, and what do you do as a contractor mainly?
Primarily, I've got a couple clients like GoRuck, who I work with. They make like backpacks and that kind of thing, and I design t-shirts and patches for them. But primarily, day-to-day, it's just logos and graphic design, that kind of stuff.
Cool. And you also do Kickstarter stuff. You had a successful Kickstarter.
Yes, that's right. In my secret identity, I am a board game publisher. We publish a game called Two Rooms and a Boom.
What's the name of your company?
Tuesday Night Games. Just give you a little plug. Thanks, man. We're working on another game right now called World Championship Russian Roulette. So occasionally I get to do little Kickstarter bootcamp consultations where I'll meet with some people who are working on a new Kickstarter, and we'll walk them through the process and give them a sort of heads up about what the experience is going to be like, what they can do to prepare for it, how they can best, you know, shoot their video and set their stretch goals, that kind of thing.
See, that's, I would think that would be big business right now.
It's a big thing right now.
Yeah, because like, or like that would be very much in need, because, you know, there's so many Kickstarter campaigns out there that just are awful, you know, and someone like you, I would think, would be very in need.
The faulty part of that like business model is that there's a huge contingent of people who are doing Kickstarter because they don't have the money to do it on their own. Mm-hmm. And then those people don't want to further spend more money before the process talking to a consultant.
Right. Do you find that the people that you're talking to, the more people who actually have money that they can spend on the Kickstarter, create more of a successful Kickstarter versus the people who are just have a cool idea and they want to put something out there?
You know, I think what makes for the most successful Kickstarters, and not like I know, we were 2 years late on ours, but it's understanding that it takes more than an idea, that ideas are cheap, but executing is what counts. And so if you're organized, you do your research, and you plan for, you know, every eventuality, I think you'll run a great Kickstarter campaign. Where people get into trouble is when they have a great idea and they hit the launch button and they just sort of roll the dice and see what happens. They're underprepared. They don't know how to communicate. And, you know, really, they're just they're basically just playing the lottery with Kickstarter, you know. But I think it's a really great platform for people who have great ideas and want to execute on them and know how to communicate to their backers, which is all a huge learning process. We didn't do a great job our first time out, but, you know, we're learning about it.
I don't know. I thought, like, here's the thing that I always think about your Kickstarter in particular, because you guys were always posting stuff about Gen Con or all these other different gaming conventions and stuff like that. And you were building this gigantic base before you even had the Kickstarter, mm-hmm. you know? And I felt like because you guys had such this big base and you already kind of had that, you had a print and play version of the game out there, that it made it a whole lot easier to fund that one.
I think
creating a following before actually throwing out the Kickstarter really helped you guys do that?
Well, for example, if you guys on BroGraph want to do a Kickstarter, you actually have a platform now. You have people that you can reach to talk about that. I think...
Oh, yeah, and we're launching a Kickstarter next week.
We are? Wait, what?
I think more often than not, you know, people just hit that launch button and then they decide to start telling people about it. Hey, I launched a Kickstarter yesterday. I think people have to be anticipating it. I think they have to see it coming. And so that's where that pre-marketing and getting out there and meeting people, building up your newsletter, whether you even know if you're going to, you know, send anything out or not, that like subscribe link should be on the front page of your website from day one, just collecting email addresses, because at the end of the day, that's all you're going to have to go on.
Totally. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see that. We've been working with a guy on a Kickstarter currently, and we've been building some 3D renderings of his stuff, and we came into the problem that Kickstarter has. Well, if you don't have the product or you're kickstarting the product or something, you can't have realistic 3D renderings of it.
They don't want to trick people. They want people to think it's real.
That's weird.
Yeah, that is weird.
Now we did come across a kind of a technicality on it, because the whole purpose of their Kickstarter is to get machinery to help them make what they've already made in bigger bulk. Mm-hmm. And so they have produce. The product. They have the product in hand, so it's kind of a different story.
I don't think there's anything wrong with putting up renderings and saying, hey, this is a rendering. This is what we think it's going to look like.
Well, yeah. I mean, the problem is we create such lifelike, realistic renderings that, you know, they're just like...
Everybody's like that, though. I think a lot of people think that, like, the pictures of the iPhones and iPads on, like, Apple's website are just really nice photographs.
Right.
I think the average person would be stunned to know that, you know, everything in the IKEA catalog, every close-up you've seen of, like, a cell phone or a watch has all been rendered.
Right. I will say, except for Samsung. Samsung's stock images that they put out are actually done by Tracy Locke here in Dallas. And it's crazy, during the launch, when I was working with Samsung during the launches and stuff like that, they would have Tracy Locke taking pictures and photoshopping the crap out of them. Wow. But I mean, they were really good images, and we'd have to go back two or three times because they would do something and then we'd get an updated model or a new phone device the way it looked or something like that, or they'd be missing the logo on the back and they'd have to either Photoshop it in or whatever. You'd open up these like 2-3 gigabyte files, Photoshop files.
Just raw. Yeah.
You know, of just everything that they did.
Well, because so wasteful.
I know it does. And, you know, one thing I hated about that job was that I couldn't get the 3D files. I wish they would have had 3D files. They could have done some really pretty videos with them. But it all ended up just being After Effects and, you know, screen replacement and stuff like that.
Weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there's a good market in it. I mean, like the one that we're working on right now, they've done a crazy amount of prep. They already have kind of an established product that they're working on, and they're putting some time and money into it, honestly. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's like going to launch like any day now. So now, how much did you raise on your Kickstarter?
$102,000. $102,000.
What was your goal?
20,000, I want to say.
I think it was 10.
Oh, maybe it was 10,000.
I'm pretty sure it was 10,000.
That's really good, though. So you were way, way above. And what?
Yeah, you guys hit your goal within like the first day, right?
24 hours, yeah.
Wow. Nice. Wow. That's really good.
And it's all about getting that user base, I think. You know, that's the one thing that I've always said to myself is that, you know, you got to have that user base if you're going
to
do that.
Was that what it was that got you to that goal so quick?
I think so. I think, and something that you guys are doing really well is, I think people have to understand that marketing at its core is about being a gift. It's not about this quid pro quo. You want to give something away for free. And I think it's been like that for a very, very long time. So for you guys, that might be tutorials, you know?
Yeah.
And for us, it was the print and play. I think a lot of beginning game designers, and I think this applies to a lot of other people in a lot of other fields, they think that their idea is great. But the real problem is nobody's even heard of them. Nobody's played the game.
Right.
So it doesn't matter if it's great or not. Nobody's heard of you. And so the best thing you could do is get yourself out there. Now, obviously, there's a lot about, you know, let yourself be taken advantage of. But
as far as like, now this is the gaming stuff that you've done. Now, what kind of advice would you give to someone who, say, is like a production person or a 3D designer who wants to go out and do like their own cartoon or their own production or something like that? How would you suggest that they go through and raise money for a Kickstarter if they wanted to do this? You know, I mean, I don't know. How do you think they would get their name out there? Because, I mean, you guys were able to go to the different conventions and have the print and play version. What about someone who's just wanting to make something that they want to submit to festivals?
Right, because a lot of that doesn't exist yet. So
correct.
What do they do? Make a short first? A trailer?
I think the old adage is sell your sawdust, right? So you're in a lumber mill and you're planing these you know, giant trees and turning them into planks of wood, and all this sawdust is coming off. Well, somebody had the idea at some point or another to package up that sawdust and sell it as its own product. So I think the first thing you have to do is look at what you're already creating as a byproduct of what you're making. So for instance, you know, I have a friend that has a great font out there. His name's Jamie Wilson. He's a great graphic designer, and he has a font called Norwester out there that he designed, and he put it out there for free. He designed it for a project he was using, but then he just thought, hey, some other people could get some good use out of this. And we were looking the other day, and we're pretty sure that the 12 Monkeys TV program used his font in their logo and all their advertising.
Very nice.
Some matchups, and it's insanely close. So if it's not, you know, his font, it's something very similar. So again, like for you guys, that's putting out tutorials. I think Freddie Wong had a lot with trying to teach people along the way. He was already working on his own sort of video work and that kind of stuff. But by teaching people, by being a gift to people, he increased awareness.
Yeah, but he was also creating, I mean, he was getting millions of hits each time with advertisements on his YouTube. I mean,
he was getting crazy hits.
I mean, he was getting like $10,000 to $20,000 per video just on advertising alone.
Sure, yeah. But I guess my point here is you have to really give back to the community in order to increase awareness of who you are. I think when people put out a trailer, they put out a Kickstarter, particularly in a creative field, my question is like, why? Why do this? But I think people who are putting out content regularly, who are, you know, being a gift to their audience, who are putting stuff out for free, who are trying to teach people, you know, trading on what they already know, I think those people build an audience exponentially faster than the people who are sort of inwardly focused, working on their own stuff, not giving back. If that's your goal, is crowdfunding, you know, if you just want to save up money and shoot your own film and have it be awesome, I think more power to you. But specifically for trying to build an audience, I think it's really important to get out there and try to make a product that people want, you know.
So now here's a question. You've also made a movie, Waiting Rooms.
That's right. Yeah.
Right.
That was quite a
while. I did not know that.
Yeah. Dave, if you want to see it, I've got it up on my server and I've had it there ever since Sean asked me to convert it for him.
Is it online somewhere?
Yeah.
Can we put it in the show notes?
Well, he's got a server, but I should put it up on YouTube or something at this point because it's been so long or on Vimeo or whatever.
So say, you know, if you knew then what you knew now about Kickstarter, because I know you fully funded the thing.
Not by myself, Nick Reed and a few other friends, yeah.
So you guys funded the whole thing yourself. Would you go back and try and do a Kickstarter for your movie? Or would you have done it the same way that you did?
Not for that movie, but certainly I think if I was going to make a movie today, I'd be looking at Kickstarter for sure. You know, I was a part of a Kickstarter campaign for a movie called Gut Boy, which my friends put together. And
how was that?
I loved it. I just saw a screener of it maybe 3 weeks ago, and I thought it was hilarious.
Okay. Did you go up to New York to watch it?
I did. I went up there for the premiere. We had a really great time. We saw it in, I forgot what it was, the Film Anthology Archives or something like that in Manhattan. It was really cool.
That's cool. That's very cool. Yeah, because I was seeing lots of posts about it.
I think the big mistake would be trying to get your entire budget covered. I think you really want to have that number be as small as possible, particularly for a movie with no like stars or credible names attached to it. I don't love the trend I'm seeing of like big name directors and actors like Zach Braff or Spike Lee using Kickstarter, because theoretically the idea is, hey, you guys have been in this industry. Whatever context you were going to make, you should have made by now.
Right.
Kickstarter should be for people who have no other options. Then again, you know, it increases awareness of Kickstarter and it brings more backers into the fold. So it's also healthy for Kickstarter as a whole. So I'm kind of conflicted on it. But
yeah,
absolutely, I'd be looking at Kickstarter if I was going to make a movie right now.
You going to make your movie that you were trying to get funded last time? What Rough
That's
Beast?
That's a great question. You know, I'm really in the board game stuff right now. You know, at some point or another, I think we'll return to you know, feature lengths or a miniseries or something like that.
Yeah, I loved the script on that one. I really think you need to do it.
I appreciate that. I think the trailer is really great. I think
the trailer was really good.
I mean, this is just true for anything you're going to do narrative wise, but for crowdfunding in particular, there needs to be a virality to what you're doing. Mm-hmm. I don't think like, hey, this is just a really good drama about the Cold War, like we'll sell on Kickstarter. But you know, I think something that has an existing audience, like an existing fan base, like, you know, zombies or Cthulhu or whatever, like we have in the board game industry, that has the ability for people to push it along and say, hey, these people are making, you know, like an Evil Dead type movie or whatever.
These people are making a cartoon about zombies who are kind of like 30 Rock.
Yeah, exactly. but yeah, I think
that'd be a very successful Kickstarter, I think.
It's probably more, I mean, you always should be thinking about your audience, but I think in the independent film world, there's so much focus put on like, hey, make the movie you want to make. But I think Kickstarter can really get you thinking outside yourself and say, hey, I'm going to ask somebody for $20 to watch this movie right now. What am I giving them in return? Mm-hmm. You know?
Cool. Yeah, I backed that Kickstarter with the retro green screen stuff. What is it called?
Retro green screen stuff.
Kung Fury.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Man, that was good. That was actually really good. But yeah, it was one of those things where if you back, then you get a copy of the movie, and it was really cool. And the what got my interest in it is that they did a trailer. So they kind of, you know, screwed around with some green screen stuff, put something kind of together, and then it was out there, and that little snippet went viral, and that's why they got the funding that they did.
Yeah. Oh, I was just going to ask something, and I don't remember what it was now. Dang it. Oh, well. Anyway.
So let's talk about your freelance stuff. Let's talk about your contract stuff. How do you go about getting business?
So never underestimate word of mouth. I think anybody can get started. You know, I started designing posters for my school theater when I was in high school with a pirated copy of Photoshop, and and you know, I just got work wherever I could, and as time went on, you know, I might have one or two graphic design or logo design projects or one or two video projects, and maybe I was working at Red Lobster at the same time or whatever, but I just kept doing them. I think one of the best things you can do starting out is make a spreadsheet that tracks what project you did, what you did on it, and how much you made, because you want to see over the next like 3, 4, 5, 10 years that number is going up. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot easier to ask for more if you can clearly remind yourself, hey, I've been doing this for really cheap for a long time. I did, you know, I shot bands live for, you know, pennies, basically. I've done all that sort of thing, but over time, you build up a reputation, you build up, you know, word of mouth. I even use that website Fiverr to design logos.
Did you really?
Oh, I use it all the time. I made probably $500 off of Fiverr last year.
Really? Now, do you find that, like, I mean, 'cause they're only paying what, $5 for a logo?
Well, eventually, when you sell enough, you get to add add-ons. Like, here, you'll get the Illustrator file if you pay me 10 extra bucks, and you'll get it in 24 hours if you pay $20 extra, and you can get some, you know, alterations if you pay another $5.
Dude, start doing some 3D files. Send them our way. We'll split the cash.
Well, it's so easy to do, and here's basically what I thought about it. Maybe I'll get one big logo design client a year, right? But I need to stay fresh, and this allows me to stay fresh and get paid. If I spend 20-30 minutes on this logo and I get paid $5 to $15, it's not the best like hourly rate in the world by any means. It's nowhere close to my actual contracting rate, but I'm getting paid to practice. And I think designers and contractors early on should get used to charging for their work and being held accountable for charging their work.
Yeah, that's actually a really good idea, because over this past week, I've been going through 3ds Max tutorials and stuff like that and trying to learn that. And I'm thinking to myself, when am I going to have a chance in order to try this stuff out? And that's actually a really good idea with Fiverr, because then it gives you a chance to like hone your craft and really just try and, you know, do actual work for people, because you could make something up, but you really don't know how it's going to be in the real world until some random person gives you something to recreate or an idea that they need. That's actually a really good idea.
I've met real clients from there. I met a guy who thought I was German because Fiverr screwed up my location, and he said, "Hey, I need a German logo." And I said, "Well, I'm not German, but I'll design you a German logo." And then I was like, "Where are you?" And he was like, "I'm in Columbus, Ohio." And I was like, "Dude, I'm going to be in Columbus, Ohio next week for a gaming convention." And then eventually I got contract work outside the website from him.
Nice.
So,
and then you sold him a copy of Two Rooms and a Boom, right?
And then I sold him a copy of Two Rooms and a Boom and a copy of Waiting Rooms. And, but yeah, I think, a lot of people feel like they shouldn't charge until they are good enough. They don't think they're good enough to charge.
I just remembered my question I was going to ask you earlier. So you created this movie. Have you considered putting it up on Netflix or Hulu or one of these streaming sites and trying to make some revenue off of that?
Well, that's not like we can't just sell to them. You know, it's not like we could just upload it and see what happens. with Waiting Rooms, it's honestly not a very good movie, and we're all sort of past it. Mm-hmm. I would like to, you know, put it up somewhere like on YouTube or Vimeo and maybe throw up an ad before it and just say like, hey, it's there. You can watch it. Mm-hmm. You know, people who are in it can always, you know, point to it and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I would say our biggest mistake we made with Waiting Rooms is we spent $10,000. We made this little family drama. You know, we shot it in a month, which was amazing, but it took maybe a year, 2 years to edit. We were really drained. We were not prepared for how long a process editing a feature is.
Mm-hmm.
And then we stopped pushing. We got to the end and we said, whew, we're tired. We see it. It's not very good. Let's just, you know, put it to bed.
Mm-hmm.
When I think in reality, what we should have done is done exactly that. Tried to really hard to get it sold, tried to take it everywhere we could take it, you know, streaming services and this and that and festivals. But I think we got a few no's early on from like South by Southwest and we were like, okay, you know, we were tired at that point.
Mm-hmm.
But once you have a product, you now have all these doors that are open to you. And I don't mean like financial doors like producers, but I mean, you now have the ability to go to festivals and ask questions and try to get in or try to get meetings with people that you don't have when you have nothing. You know what I mean? So you've spent mm-hmm. all this money, you might as well learn everything you can possibly learn. And that affects us in board gaming today. We have opportunities with different companies and we have to say, hey, you know, at the very least, we should learn as much as possible about this opportunity before we say yes or no. You know, and that seems like obviously it would be true, but sometimes you think, oh, we don't want to do that. And so you just say no immediately. When in reality, what you should do is keep pushing, keep asking questions, meet with the people, you know, see what they're looking for before you say no, because at the very, you know, you can learn.
Yeah, that's cool. That's really good. Good advice.
On some of your projects, let's go into this topic a little bit. And this is what we're talking about on BroGraph this week. On some of your projects, when you're working on a piece for a client and you've gone back and forth on them, on it a few times with them, they've done some revisions and such, and then you're kind of to a point where you could probably keep working on it, but they're happy with it. It's going to do the trick. How long do you spend making revisions that probably only you would notice?
Yeah, at what point do you
no
say
time at all.
Enough is enough?
when they're happy, I ship it. You know, usually mm-hmm. When I talk to a client, I talk about a specific number of revisions. And I don't try to hold their feet to the fire or anything, but I say, hey, this is how it works. You know, for your project, it's going to involve, you know, a round of sketches and then some notes and then a draft, some notes, and then a final. And so we have like sort of the lay of the land out there. And I say, I estimate that process is going to take, you know, 30 hours at this rate or 15 hours at this rate or whatever. But it could go over and under depending on how many revisions you want. And usually I try to be the aggressor. I try to push. So I set my own deadlines and I, you know, I send them a file and say, hey, here are the sketches. And I number them. Do you have any thoughts? And if a week goes by and, you know, I haven't heard anything, I say, hey, I'm going to work on firming up my favorite, which is number 3, unless you have other thoughts, you know, because you can really wait forever for a client.
Of course.
If you let them.
Mm-hmm.
But a little bit of pressure can help a lot. But when they're in that final stage of, you know, everything looks good, but you haven't gotten the final clear, what I find is best to do is just send them the deliverables. Send them the things you agreed on, you know, your 8.5x11 PDF or your vector file or, you know, the small, medium, and large ping or JPEG or whatever it is that you're supposed to send them. Send it to them and say, here you go, here's the final. And leave it on them to say, actually, I need these revisions, you know. But at this mm-hmm. point, you've done your job. You've delivered what you consider to be a final. And I think you should have your own standards of professionalism. But for me, it's all about making the client happy. I could work on things forever and forever and forever, but I think you learn a lot more completing a project, getting it out there and moving on to the next project than you do endlessly iterating on the same one.
Totally.
I agree. You ever,
with me, if a client says it's good, even though like, say I do some rotoscoping or something like that, and I notice it every single time it plays. If the client doesn't notice it, I'm not going to say anything. Because as soon as you do, then they're like, oh yeah, can we go ahead and fix that?
Right. I will kind of go clean some stuff up or spend a little extra time, but that's what our BroGraph talk is about this week. It should be coming out tomorrow, is about like working on stuff like that. You may kind of spend a little extra time on something, but really you got to know when to call it quits. You got to know when enough is enough. And especially if you're in like a work environment, you got a job and you got to stay within budget, you got to kind of let some things go sometimes. And for people like us, I think it's a difficult thing to do because we tend to be a little perfectionist about it, mm-hmm. you know, or want to take it the extra step. But you can always come back and do it later if you really want to.
Yeah, if you wanted to add it to your reel, you know, yeah. and you notice some stuff or you say, hey, I want to make this more shiny or give it a different texture or whatever. Yeah, always go back to it. Hold on to your files. But yeah, you're right. I mean, in my opinion, if the client says it's good, it's good.
No, I think it's also about learning how to execute something in a certain amount of time. If you budget yourself 8 hours to work on a project, well, and you spend 10 hours on it, you haven't really learned what you can accomplish in 8 hours, you know? And I think
right.
one of the best things about being a contractor is being consistent and saying, for this price in this much time, this is exactly the quality I can deliver. But if you stay up every night and you burn the candle at both ends, not only are you devaluing your hourly rate by spending more hours on something than you really should, but you're also not learning what you would have needed to do in the future to get it done in time. Does that make sense?
Totally.
Yeah, you got to learn how to work smarter, not harder.
Mm-hmm.
As totally. The cliche goes. That wasn't a cliche a few years ago. Now it's a cliche almost, but but it is true. So,
totally.
Now tell me what you do as far as client revisions that are beyond the scope of the project. How do you go about telling your client, because I know sometimes that's a sensitive subject that you have to kind of bring up and be like, eh, you know, that we really didn't agree on that. How do you
Absolutely.
Get through that?
This is funny because Fiverr, again, will give you a lot of hours in the log about doing this kind of thing. So, for example, on Fiverr, somebody, I say each of my files comes with one free round of revisions, anything from a tiny tweak to a complete overhaul. And so I remind them, I say, hey, here's your logo. And if you want anything from a tiny tweak to complete overhaul, you got one free revision that comes with it. And I sort of try to sell it as a benefit, as a positive.
Mm-hmm.
And then they get around to revisions. I say, cool, here you go. That's it. I don't leave it open. I don't ask them questions I don't want the answer to. I don't say things like, do you like it? If it's good, let me know if there's any changes you want to make. I just say, here you go. Thanks for the awesome project. Because the thing I've learned is, the client knows they can always ask you for more. You don't need to leave the door open. It's on them to ask for more that's outside of the scope. Now, mm-hmm. it's important to set that scope early on. But another thing to remember is not to take it personally. People are always going to ask for more. And you can't, you know, sit there and think, man, I stayed up all night last night trying to get this done. They didn't tell me about this in the beginning. That wasn't the way it was. If they ask for a change, you feel like it's honestly outside the scope of the original agreement, I just try to make it a really happy thing. I try to say, awesome, that sounds great. For that, you know, to make that addition or make that change, you know, here's a quote. It's going to take me another X hours and it's going to cost a little bit X amount. The goal should be, you should be excited to do the work, but it should come with a price tag. You shouldn't say, hey man, look, we really didn't agree on that. And I really don't have the time to do it. Blah, blah, blah. You should come back with, that sounds like a great idea. For, you know, those revisions and any other revisions, it's going to cost an extra $35 an hour, $50 an hour, or whatever. Just let them know what's going on. And if they freak out on you, I think you've learned something about that client.
Right.
That's smart. I like that.
Do you have any clients that, which is a great client to have, do you have any clients where they really don't care how much it's going to cost? It's just kind of like, bill me however many hours it is.
You know, I have a couple like clients who we've started to trust each other over the years that we've been working together. And so, you know, I'm filling out automated invoices and I'm getting direct deposits, you know, once a week for sort of ongoing work as if I were an employee of theirs.
Mm-hmm.
And those are the clients you have to protect because they don't ask any questions. You know, they're obviously reviewing your work and reviewing your hours. They're not giving me a blank check, you know, like, in film, it's a lot different than in graphic design because in graphic design, I'm uploading files on a day-to-day basis. But on a video or film project or a 3D project, they might go weeks without seeing anything, you know,
right.
and you might go way, 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 way over budget in those weeks, buying models and doing overtime and, you know, custom textures and lights and that kind of stuff. That kind of thing, I think, you know, you have to keep them aware of. But, yeah, I've definitely got clients who, you know, they ask for the work and I do whatever it takes to get done and we don't, you know, send estimates or anything like that.
And what about contracts? Do you do contracts with anybody?
Like, do I do actual physical paper contracts?
Or online, or...
You know, I do that more in my board gaming stuff than in my graphic design sort of world.
Mm-hmm.
But again, that comes from word of mouth. Most of my clients are coming from people that I trust, people like you guys or other friends, that kind of thing. And we work without paper for as long as possible. I feel like the people I have to bring in contracts with are the people that I almost don't want to be in business to begin with. if that makes sense. Like, if it's got to be put down on paper, like, hey, you legally have to do this. Otherwise, we're going to do this. It's like, I'm already starting to look over my shoulder and it's not worth it.
Mm.
You know, but, you know, Nexus Motion and everything you guys do have always, you know, paid great, paid on time.
Yeah, we have.
Kept up great communication.
so
that makes
Square,
you a client that
so
I
you get
would,
it like the day of.
Oh, absolutely. And that makes you guys a client that I would protect and that I would, you know, bend over backwards for. I've had clients that say, hey, the check's in the mail, and then it's not there. And you know, and you're thinking like, all right, is this something I have to be worried about? Because it's sort of like that movie, It Follows. Like, if they don't pay, then I got to go back to the person that recommended them and say, hey, this happened. And then I got to go back to the person that recommended them and say, hey, this happened. And you sort of got to trace it back to where you have somebody who's good again and, you know, not take work from the other people.
And we always kind of protect ourselves by, with new clients at least, getting 50% down until we feel them out and we kind of know what they're like. But
that's,
you know,
really smart.
There's people that, you know, we work with from time to time that show up, and it's usually by recommendation, so I'm not too worried about it. If they call out of the blue, it's kind of another thing. But we do get people through recommendation that are, you know, out of state and stuff, and you know, that's a tougher thing to follow up on if there is trouble with payment. So, you know, we tend to do contracts at least at first. We use a service called CudaSign, which used to be called SignNow. And
did that just recently change?
It did just recently change. I think they got bought out. And so we have an account with them, and it is extremely affordable. What's really cool is you can make anything you want as a PDF. And then you just put it in there, and you put fields for signatures and all that kind of stuff. So
I'm just thinking of the great contracts you could have someone sign, just like a picture of your butt or something. Send that as a PDF.
Sign my contract. But it is really
on the
cool.
Left butt cheek.
It'll save your signature and all that, so you can put that in there. But then you can just go in and you just stamp little areas on your deal, and you say, you know, sign here, and it emails it to them. It only takes a second. I think, Sean, I probably sent you one for the
commercial.
We were working on a big commercial spot. I sent them to everybody for all sorts of stuff, workman's comp and all
you're
these.
You're a great producer, man. You are way on top of all that stuff.
Yeah.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank
you. Dude, Sean, you're a great assistant director.
Yeah, you did a good job.
You were so good about remembering everyone's name.
It was a really great circumstance because I think we really hit our roles like dead on in that situation.
For the listeners, we were doing a commercial. We got hired to do a commercial, and Sean, I was the director, Dave was the producer, and Sean was my assistant director. And Sean was awesome about knowing everyone's name, because I am awful at it. So I would direct, and I would tell people what I wanted, and then Sean would actually tell it in normal terms.
No, I think it was really good. I would do that job, you know, once a week, every week, for the rest of my life. I think, you know, it was a happy set. Everybody was joking around. The product was good. Everybody was just on point, which you don't see a lot.
And we got done early.
Two tellies for it.
Two tellies? Yeah. You guys got done early. Like, very, very good stuff.
You know, Sean, if you want a telly, you could just let us know. We'll get you one. You'll have to pay
bucks.
For it. Yeah.
You'll have to pay
for it. They're more than that.
Oh, they are? I thought they were pretty expensive.
$195 a piece.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many did we buy? End up buying? All together?
How many total between every 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7,
whoa.
8 of them? 8 of them.
Why did you guys buy so many?
Well, Dave and I each bought 2, you know, because we wanted both of ours. Plus certificates. And then the guy who, the advertising agency who went through us, We got ones for them, and then we got one for their client, and
we basically split the price on one for their client to give mm-hmm. them, you know, just for like as a thank you for hiring all of us.
It's starting to make the telly sound like a huge scam.
Oh, of course it is.
Trophies.
Of course it is. I mean, our entry fees were what we spent like $400 in entry fees.
Oh yeah, it was ridiculous.
We spent
$400 in entry fees and another $400 in trophy fees.
We spent $1,600 on trophies total.
Yeah,
man,
and certificates because we got certificates too.
Do people in the industry pay attention to that stuff? To get here. I mean, is a telly going to look nice in the office?
From what I've heard,
your clients do.
Yeah, if the clients don't know what the tellies are, oh yeah, it looks great.
Definitely.
But from what I've heard, if you're going to try and win something, don't go so much for the telly. Go for more of the local Emmy award.
Yeah,
because they do commercials and stuff for Emmy Awards, and like if
Clio's are big too.
Yeah,
Clio's, the Addies as well.
Yeah,
but the thing about the Emmys is that you can only like get in like if you know somebody else who recommends you into the group. Like it's not like you can just go enter it.
Well, we've got Lance. Lance, yeah, won one.
We should talk to Lance.
Mm-hmm. Anyway.
And what I was going to say about Kudasign, though, is, man, it's cheap. It is so cheap. It was like $64 for 3 years worth of unlimited contracts.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
That's so really good. If you ever need to do that, I would definitely recommend
it. Can you also
do
a trial with your email address?
You used to be able to do that. Okay. Now it's set up to where you have to do a trial with credit cards, so it's going to start automatically charging you, which I don't really like that model. But
yeah. Everyone uses it, though.
Yeah, it's a good system.
Yeah.
Sean, are you good? Do you want to move
I
off?
I could call it right there. Going? Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Well, Sean McCoy, awesome guy extraordinaire. You guys can check out his company, Tuesday Night Games. That's where he does all of his gaming stuff. You can also check out his podcast. It's actually slowly become one of my favorite podcasts. It's Tuesday Night Podcast. He's on there. And then Sean, where can people contact you if they want to ask any more questions?
You can find me on Twitter at Sean McCoy, SEANMCCOY.
Awesome. Well, Sean, thanks for being on the show.
Thanks
a
lot.
We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
All right. So, Dave, you do any fun stuff this week? Any good projects worth mentioning?
In all honesty, my stress level is through the roof right now for reasons that we will probably talk about in a future podcast. But
that's always kind of the case with you.
Oh,
you're always kind of stressed through the roof.
Not in this way, trust me. What did I do? I did the BroGraph talk. I've been mm-hmm. working a lot in Octane. I did a really interesting Octane mixed with VFX and green screening thing this mm-hmm. week, and you
are
know,
you able
I
to post that at all? Or
yeah, have, I mean this
it
version
didn't have any branding or anything on it, right?
Right. No, that will actually be up. I'll probably add that to Behance. I'll probably because cool. I'm really proud of it. I'll probably add it.
It looked good. Did you finish the background layers?
That has to render tonight.
Okay. Cool. Do you need my computer tonight. To render?
I don't think so, because I won't be at my computer after that. So, I mean, you know, I got time on that. That was really fun, like doing green screen stand-ins in Octane mm-hmm. and then turning off the scene by camera, but allowing it to just create shadows and reflections.
That's cool.
And then you go back into After Effects, you do a external compositing tag in mm-hmm. Cinema 4D, and then you bring it in to After Effects, and then you put it back in, and you can, you know, it really looks better.
Did the external compositing tag work right for, and which way did you go? Did you import
perfect.
The project, or did you export out a...
I always do AEC.
Man, because the always. Bringing in the project just sucks. I have run into that so many times this
past week.
You
never want to do that. You never want to do that, dude. Like, it's horrible.
I had
it's
to redo...
Really horrible.
I had a Microsoft video that I was doing this week, mm-hmm. and basically, they send us the project, and they're like, oh, yeah, it's in a layered file, blah, 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 and so we get it, and no, it's just an MOV, and so they want us to rotoscope out tons of stuff, like rotoscoping out screens and changing the way the screen looks and stuff like that, and then re-rendering out moving images of the phone devices and stuff like that. And then I had to replace the screens in all of them because for some reason, I don't know if I'm doing it wrong, but in Octane, when you render a screen out on a phone, it just doesn't look crisp. It doesn't look crisp at all.
What do you mean it doesn't look?
It just looks, it looks dull and it looks kind of blurry, you know?
Now, how are you setting up that screen though? Like, what are you?
Is it an
emission?
Yes, I'm using an emission texture. So I'll put my screen on the emission texture, and it just doesn't look as crisp as if I were compositing that in. So that's what I've got to do is, you know, after the fact, composite everything in.
And I wish it was, I'd have to see. You know,
and here's what's dumb. I wish in Octane, I wish if you've got your renderer set as Octane, like it will also do the regular standard object buffers as well. Like I hate having to go through and redo object buffers, you know, second, even though it only takes like a couple minutes.
But well, you can do Octane.
Oh, buffers. I know, but they take a while. I mean, you've got to do an extra 125 or 128 samples per thing.
Oh, we talked about that last week.
Yeah, you don't want to do that, you know, for 300 frames. Oh, that would be awful.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I think they need to come out with a solution to get get buffers back out, not necessarily Octane, but just in general, Cinema 4D, without rendering. There's got to be a way to quickly get those out.
You would think that Cineware would be able to do that easily, you know?
Well, like, Cineware is only an extension of Cinema 4D, a slower extension of Cinema 4D. That's why I don't use it, man. It's just not, there is no good use for it for me.
I will import my project so that I can bring in my camera. That's the only thing that I do in Cineware, because the camera always brings in fine.
AEC, I know,
but it's my external compositing tag that always seems to get messed up whenever I'm doing stuff in Cineware. So anyway,
I don't know why.
So
you were
doing all these things. You should put your Behance in the show notes so that people can see this video, because it is pretty sweet.
I'll put that in there. I'm starting to kind of build that up. In fact, I'll write that down now.
Good.
Behance. All right. So here's the thing. Like, I was doing something with cars, and it is hard to do cars, let me tell you. And I should probably do a tutorial on this. I actually have it written down. And these cars are kind of flipping around, and as they flip, they kind of wiggle. You know, like when they stop.
Secondary motion.
Yeah, the shocks kind of move into place. So I'm putting the center of gravity of the body kind of low, and then the tires don't move at all. So the tires are kind of separate from the car. But the thing is, when you're working with cars, you know, you get these cars from different places, and some of them are good, some of them are bad. These particular ones that I had were really good, but and pretty
they were
high
models
poly.
That you bought, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a ton of them. And the thing about doing that in Octane is that, you know, your polys are going to be really high.
Yeah, for sure.
And, you know, you're looking at a million polygons per car. Some of them were less. But not a lot less. I think the lowest was 700K.
How did you go about retexturing them? Did you actually just create Octane tags, or were you able to just right-click and convert materials?
Well, what I did is I converted materials first. And then I started grouping around the glass for one. You know, because there would be three or four different types of glass. I grouped those together. And honestly, just I would click them all at the same time and change the parameters to make them all the same at the same time. So here's my glass. If I needed to change anything specific, I would. But... the other thing that I would do is then find that one main car paint texture, rename that paint. That's my paint, right? And I take all the other stuff and I would make them glossy all together at the same time with no roughness, and then just adjust from there. If there's anything that's super obvious, I would find that one texture and change it. Otherwise,
leave everything,
you know,
the way it is.
Little bits and pieces here and there. Who cares? You know, make the interiors whatever color and blur the reflections a bunch and... That's it, right?
Yeah, that's what I have a tendency to do as well. Anytime, like with a few of the phone devices that I've gotten, because we get step files, and I'll mm-hmm. take those step files and then I'll convert them to a Cinema 4D file using, what's the program?
NewGraph.
NewGraph, yeah.
Yeah.
And so then I'll bring those directly into Cinema 4D and I'll just convert the materials, and the ones that I need to convert or change, I'll change, and the ones, you know, some of them I don't need to.
And generally I would have usually a silver and a chrome texture, because hubcaps are usually very chrome-ish, but they're blurred, so they would be considered silver. And then all that kind of painted, not even chrome, but like, you know, that fake painted chrome and grills and stuff, I would make just, you know, index of one and no roughness or anything.
So. And how were you going about making, were you doing anything special for the car paint material? Because I know with V-Ray and with the new renderer in R16, there were specific car paint materials that you could do. You know, is there anything like that you added in there to specifically, you know, show it was car paint, or did you just do a super glossy, you know?
I did it super glossy. Now, that's because I'm trying to save time, and in this situation,
it's fine. Yeah, and you were also at a distance, so it didn't really matter that much.
Now, if I were going to do,
still look real.
Oh, man, they are super impressive, and, you know, just having them all together in one scene is super fun to mess with.
Totally.
The calculation time is what you have to deal with.
Yeah.
Now, the thing about, man, there were so many obstacles that I could get into in this
Did
project.
Did you ever get over the instancing stuff?
Yes. So here's the instancing thing. Now, the thing is, in the background of this scene, there's a bunch of other cars, right? And I'm not going to do like, you know, 25 different cars. I'm going to do kind of like different versions of the same car with just different paint.
Mm-hmm.
So every car I would make would have the tires, and it would have the body, and then it would have the color.
Mm-hmm.
The color was any part that would have that paint texture. The body was everything else but the tires. So each one of those, I would put in a master car null, and then and underneath that is the null for each section. So the master car, you'd actually turn off. You'd actually don't let that show anywhere. Mm-hmm. And then you would instance what's underneath, because if you instance what's underneath and they're on, then it will still appear. So you don't see the master car anywhere in the scene.
Mm-hmm.
But then you turn on those instances for each of those, and then you turn on render instances, so that if you have 10 versions of that car, and they're each a million polys, it's not 10 million polys in your scene.
Right.
It's just 1 million polys for that car.
Right.
1 million polys for the next car, because you got enough to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that the most, you could see more or less cars at certain times. The more or less cars that I had going at once were like 7 million polys. And your calculation time, your render time is going to be okay, but your calculation time gets pretty bad.
Yeah, totally.
The way that I went about kind of fixing this is I would turn off the overall visibility, which is general visibility, to where once the thing was out of the scene, I would keyframe it at one, and then I would keyframe it the next frame at zero, so it would be out of the scene. Then all of a sudden, when you have it at zero, Octane sees, okay, this thing is gone, I'm not going to calculate it anymore.
Oh, that's cool.
And
that's
the other really thing cool. is you have to do it that way, because if you try and keyframe your render, visible in renderer, you're going to have a bad time. it'll accidentally, like, not turn it off while you're rendering, even though it's doing a check. And it just, it'll get super messy. So what I would do is I would keyframe visible in editor along with the object tag with the general visibility settings.
That's cool. That's very cool.
The other thing that I ran into is I was doing motion blur in camera. And so this gets to a whole nother level of craziness. But
and why did you choose to do it that way instead of RSMB?
It looks so much better.
Yeah.
I mean, RSMB is great, but the thing about RSMB is that sometimes, even if you're doing RSMB the right way, if you have background elements that are not moving behind fast-moving objects, you're going to get weirdness along the edges.
Yeah.
And so, and not only that, but this blur is so good.
Yeah.
The thing that it does, though, is you have to adjust the shutter of your camera and say, how far ahead is the shutter? within that frame. And so like if something is rotating, let's say, and you adjust the shutter, you'll see it, the object, in different places. And so when I was using this, this kind of became an issue because I was using a stage. And on when it would flip on the stage to another camera, like those first two frames would be weird, as if it was transitioning. Transitioning from one camera to the other, because the shutter is kind of an in-between frame thing. So, you know, really my solution for that is the camera only changed maybe 4, 5, 6 times. And I just went back and like turned off the stage for those couple frames and re-rendered two frames here, two frames there.
When I've never actually messed with motion blur. I've done all my stuff through RSMB instead of doing it specifically through Octane. Now, I know the motion blur looks better in Octane from what I've heard.
I just got started in it too. So
yeah. So, well, can you see the motion blur in your interactive preview renderer?
You can. It's not, I think I sent you a screenshot of like a car that looked all funky yesterday.
You might have. I don't know. I've seen a bunch of screenshots
See funkiness. You'll see like weird things going on. You have to step forward like 4 or 5 frames before the motion blur kicks in. It's really weird. But also it's only showing camera motion blur. It's not showing full motion blur. And when you go to render in your settings, you have the option of full motion blur, camera motion blur, or no motion blur at all. And so once you kick that in, I think I also use transform and vertex motion blur, which is, I think a little bit better for what I was doing specifically. I mean, it is a pain. I mean, it pays off because it looks just phenomenal. Yeah. But
yeah, it looks really good. It looks real good.
So you got to work with those instances if you're doing big projects like this. Keep your poly count down. Man, anything you can do is going to severely improve your render time. And
how long was your render time running per frame?
It was going
with calculation and everything.
56 seconds a frame.
Wait, is that with calculation?
Yeah.
Really? Yeah. You got it down to 56 altogether?
Yeah, because I told it to only, I told it to do manual geometry calculation in this render settings. And then I told it to only calculate objects that change. So it only calculated stuff that had an object tag on it.
It
was very specific, because then it was only, you know, if you got a bunch of cars and they're sitting there not moving, and then you got one that does like a rotation or something, then from one frame to the other, the geometry calculation time is only calculating 1 million polys and not 7 million polys.
Gotcha.
So, smart. I mean, it's little things, but figure it out.
Here's what is crazy to me. Like, you have 7 million polys. Did you do a test render on just the physical render to see how long it took? It would have taken.
Oh, I didn't even try. I didn't have the textures on it.
Well, you should try that, because I would love to know the difference between the standard physical render versus Octane. You know, because you're talking about 1 minute for this huge, gigantic, like beautifully realistic scene, and it's one computer. That's what blows my mind.
It's one computer, and it was 747 frames. It rendered in 10 hours.
That's so
ridiculous.
And
there was something like, I don't remember how many cars.
Because people are spending like, you know, thousands of dollars in order to buy in these, to bring in these big render nodes and stuff like that. Could you imagine if you had just one whole computer or several computers full of these, you know, full of 980 Ti's?
Yeah.
Dude, you'd be able to render out that entire commercial in like just like an hour or so.
Yeah. You know, and it's exponential in that it's, you know, if I had two computers.
Yeah, see, if you would have used mine too, you would have gotten it done in 5 hours.
5 hours.
That's
5 crazy.
Hours.
And that was at 256 samples, I believe.
That's like less than a work day.
Yeah, it's crazy. It rendered overnight. The next morning, I think I had 20 minutes left after I woke up. And, you know, when it goes that fast, you know, the only thing that I didn't have, that didn't look good was there were a couple shadow areas and mainly light reflection areas on some windows that were a little speckly and could have used some more samples.
Yeah, and it's like that's the number one thing that I've found that I hate with Octane is rendering glass.
You get those little blocky. Mm-hmm. They're not even dots. They're like blocky things.
When you're doing like phones and stuff like that, and you're not using PMC or path tracing, you're using direct lighting, glass kills me because I've got to up those, the especially when you're doing close-up shots, you've got to up the sample rate just a ridiculous amount. You're talking like 2,000 samples in direct lighting, which is crazy.
Yeah, but I paid a lot of attention to my lights because my master light, the one that really made the big difference, had it was a 10-to-1 ratio over any backlighting or anything.
Oh, interesting.
And hot pixel removal wouldn't get rid of this. I actually used Magic Bullet's noise reduction tool. Mm-hmm. It's really good, and I used it at about 200%. And you know, you got to find the middle ground because you don't want it to kind of soften your image.
Yeah, totally.
But it worked like a charm. Absolutely. Yeah. And the only downside to that is you actually have to do it gets rid of your alpha channel when you add that for some reason, and you can't put a noise reduction on a pre-comp. So what you have to do is put the noise reduction onto the master render and then like duplicate that render and use itself as an alpha channel. So
interesting. Well, cool. And so that's what you were working on all weekend?
All weekend. And then I was working on another thing using displacement and audio files.
Oh, yeah. You sent me that little thing. That's cool.
And
that's
I did a Brograph talk. Man, I've just been...
Crushing it.
Crushing it, man. Crushing
it. Well, I worked on the new logo. Like, we've got the new logo. I worked on the 3D animation for it. Mm-hmm. And I will tell you, I spent an entire day working on it, you know, which if you watch it... Once we get the sound effects and the new music and stuff, like, you will be like, well, why did this take you all day? And it's because I have a child. And
I'm trying to really didn't take you all day. You just stopped a lot.
Watch my 2-year-old while I'm trying to get this done. And, you know, he's 2. So he says yes and no and yes and no. And he doesn't know what he's talking about most of the time. So
see,
you have to have patience while you're doing that, too.
I'm at the point where my daughter now... can come in here, like if my wife isn't around and she's got to go somewhere, I'm like, okay, I have to work, but as long as you hang out in my office. I mean, she's got the iPad and all that, but
yeah, get her on Steam and she's just poning some noobs.
Oh, she plays Batman, Lego Batman 3 on Xbox. Nice. And the thing is, you know, she's only 5.5, so she runs into problems sometimes. Mm-hmm. And so what I've done is I've put a link to the YouTube channel for this guy who does a walkthrough on all of it. Uh-huh. So now it's to the point, which is it was like working before, it was like I had to keep stopping and help her fix the level, and I'm like, you know, if you want to play games, you got to figure it out yourself.
That's funny.
You know,
or
so
have someone show you how to do it.
Yeah, so now she just does the walkthroughs if she's stuck, and she's totally self-sufficient if I have to work. So you'll get there.
That's
you'll
really
get there.
Funny.
You got to get an Xbox for your office, though.
Yeah, I know, right? Well, see, what I've been doing is because I, you know, I like spending time with my family and stuff like that. So I've got my laptop and I got my computer upstairs. You know, and I don't, I want to sit down in the living room while we're hanging out or something like that. I don't like being stuck up in my office. I'll just screen share my upstairs computer straight to my downstairs laptop. Mm-hmm. And I'll just be working in Octane on my laptop the whole time.
It's nice.
Yeah, it is nice.
Now, pretty soon, I'm sure they'll have like Octane servers and we won't even have to worry about it anymore.
Yeah, let's hope.
That'd be great.
Yeah, then I wasted, you know, $3,000 on a Mac.
It's still great to work in. Now,
love this Monster Mac.
Here's what I did.
Now that I finally have Windows 7 installed.
Oh, yeah. Finally. What's the deal with that?
I got it installed, last week or something? I finally got it installed. And
You told me last week that boot camp wouldn't work with El Crappy Tan. That was our thing.
So like I ran into, Sunday, had I gotten everything up and running? I hadn't gotten it up and running.
No,
yet,
we were talking about that.
Okay. So I finally got.
This was after the podcast when you sent me a text and told me you thought that you blew up your Mac.
Oh yeah. Okay, so with that, okay, yeah. So Monday, no, did I took Monday off. Mm-hmm. Tuesday I went to work and I asked my IT guy, I said, hey, can I just borrow this SSD, my SSD, my main Mac SSD, so that I, because it's got Yosemite on it, I can put my Yosemite drive in. I don't have to worry about taking out my graphics cards and it'll be fine. And then I mm-hmm. can get Windows 7 installed on this hard drive. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure, take it. No problem. So I take it out. I get home. I pop it in and it won't start up. And I start hearing this noise and I'm like, oh no, what did I do? So I pulled it out and then I plugged in my normal drive and that wouldn't boot up either. And I'm like, oh no, what did I do? Did I just fry my computer? I don't know what's going on. So I've been going through all these problems for the past like 2 weeks, all because I don't want to take out my graphics cards.
Right.
And really, like the amount of time that I have spent just trying not to take out the graphics cards, I finally decided, screw it, I'm taking out the graphics cards. It took me like 5 minutes.
Right.
You know, it was ridiculous that I went through all this trouble in order to try and do this. So anyway, turn off my computer, unplug it, put in my old graphics card, put in my hard drive. Oh, and I tried booting up my work's hard drive on my iMac because I've got a little SATA to USB thing and it didn't work. I'm like, oh no, I fried my work computer or my work hard drive. What am I going to do? And so I plug in my old graphics card. I put in my hard drive. It works. I'm like, oh, thank goodness. Thank goodness. And so I take out my hard drive and I plug in my work hard drive and it doesn't work. And I'm like, oh no, I've totally fried it. So I put in my hard drive again. I put in my work hard drive. Turns out I grabbed the secondary drive and not the main hard drive.
That'll do it.
Yep. So I don't know why my secondary drive is on an SSD on my first bay of my work computer, but whatever. So anyway, then I had my graphics card, my old one, put in. So I just decided to put in my Yosemite drive, and then I couldn't get Boot Camp to run. And it's like, no, this won't run with this computer. I'm like, well, this is the whole reason I've got Yosemite. Turns out I had to reset my PRAM, and then I finally was able to install Windows 7.
Man.
Through Boot Camp. But now I've got El Capitan running, and I tried what you said, Boot Champ, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Boot Champ won't work. It Why doesn't... Won't- No, Boot Champ does not work with El Capitan. With El Capitan going over to a Windows computer, with this one that we specifically have, the 2009 Mac Pro. So if you've got a newer Mac Pro or something like that, or you know, one of the laptops or iMacs or something, it will work. But I mean, then you just need to use Boot Camp. I mean, you could use Boot Camp.
So
the thing I like about Boot Champ is that it doesn't, you know, reset which one it starts in. You know.
So how are you going to switch now?
Oh, I have to turn off my computer and I have to switch out hard drives manually.
Oh,
yeah.
Makes me not want to upgrade.
Honestly, I've run into nothing but problems with El Capitan, so I would hold off on it. But the greatest thing I love about El Capitan, I've got dual monitors. When I can't find my mouse, I shake it back and forth and it right. becomes gigantic.
I have El Capitan on everything but this computer right now.
Yeah.
And the thing is, I can't upgrade my iCloud notes to do all the cool, fun, new stuff and sharing.
I can't even tell you how much I hate that I can't run Numbers on my freaking laptop because I don't have El Capitan installed. It's so stupid.
Are you serious?
I can't run Numbers. Like, so when I want to do my budget, I literally have to do my budget on my phone.
Why is it not backwards compatible? That's stupid.
It's so stupid. And freaking this happens Apple, every single time they upgrade to a new operating system. If I upgrade my iPhone to iOS 9, mm-hmm. you know, and didn't upgrade my computer to El Capitan, I can't use Numbers on my laptop.
Oh, so not the program itself, but something that was saved in the El Capitan.
No, I cannot use Numbers by itself. Oh, no. I don't know.
Yeah, I think I ran into that before, and it's true, because I used to have a schedule at work, and then when I upgraded my computer, or I upgraded my phone, and I did something on my phone, and then I couldn't open it on my computer. It's so dumb. So dumb.
It is dumb.
Now, here's what I've done this week in order to...
Yeah, no, I just opened it up. It says a free Numbers update is available, and boo so earns. I can't do anything. Yeah, boo earns indeed.
Here's what I did in order to keep myself productive. Mm-hmm. Number one is I can only get on Reddit pics if I'm in the bathroom.
Okay.
That's so number one.
You found that you take extended bathroom breaks?
Or if I'm rendering. But when I'm rendering, mm-hmm. I've been playing Halo 5. Ah. But what I have done, though, is I've created a Facebook 9x9 rule.
Okay.
And that is, when I get up, I can get on Facebook and, you know, do whatever on it. Mm-hmm. Up until 9 o'clock when I really start working. I pretty much get down to, I might be surfing the web or doing a couple things, but I really don't get down to working until about 9 a.m., right?
Okay.
Now, once I get on there, I post something, I troll somebody, I do whatever I'm going to do on Facebook mm-hmm. for the time being, and then I do not go back to Facebook until 9 o'clock p.m.
That's smart. I like that idea.
And only on my computer. Facebook is not on my phone.
You deleted it again.
Man, I installed it and deleted it like twice this week just to post a couple pictures.
That's funny.
Well, it's
you should try the browser. I bet you can post stuff from the browser.
Yeah, but if you're out and about, you're going, I don't know, you're going clubbing. You're going to a concert. You're going to a restaurant with a whole bunch of people, all that. You're taking pictures and posting and back and forth. You're out there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. You install Facebook, just delete it later. And that's really my methodology on that. And mm-hmm. once, like during the work week, you just do whatever. You just do whatever and you don't have Facebook and Reddit pics is, and I'll surf Reddit pics when I'm trying to fall asleep or something.
Yeah.
Like, productivity hack right there, man.
That's a good idea. I should do that with Imgur.
Mm-hmm. You know? Bathroom and bed.
Yeah. Bathroom and bed. That's good. Okay.
Got to find some alliteration. Pooping and dreaming and...
Pooping and producing.
Dumping and dreaming. I don't know.
Pooping. Okay, no.
I don't know.
The rest of our podcast can't be about this.
All right.
If you have a good suggestion on what we should do, send us an email. Brograftoots@gmail.com. T-U-T-S.
So, other things that happened this week, selecting insurance, the mm-hmm. Obamacare thing went live.
Yeah.
So that's been interesting. As a contractor, if you are trying to select insurance, mm-hmm. or if you work at a job where they don't provide insurance, the mm-hmm. same deal, it's that time to get an open enrollment.
And, you know, even if you have a company that will offer insurance, but you're, as here's the best thing about being a freelancer, or doing contract work as your own business, you can write off your insurance.
You can, oh, yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, yeah. Even if you have a job and you do contract work, you can get private insurance yourself and be able to write it off as your company or as your freelance, you know, insurance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because
this will be the first expensive. Year. Yeah, this is the first year that I have had insurance for the entire year through a job. And I'm going to tell you, it's going to kill me when tax time comes back because I'm not going to get so big of a refund, you know, because yeah. I mean, I was looking at $3,600 every year in a deduction, which is awesome, you know? Anyway, that's,
and it's going to be probably around the $300 range for, mm-hmm. or more for, good insurance. The thing about picking insurance, especially if you're a contractor, is honestly, let's be honest here. If you're getting insurance, you're really getting it in case of the catastrophic event, right? Because yeah. you go to the doctor, you can pay $100, go to the doctor, go to Walmart, get a $5 prescription.
Yeah.
You know, unless it's something crazy that you have to get on, if you have some sort of condition where you need expensive medication. Mm-hmm. So it's really about that. So your deductible, you'll probably never hit it. You know,
yeah.
You'll never get that.
I haven't hit my deductible, but once probably ever. And
right.
That was because I had to get a stupid MRI that ended up being nothing.
Yeah, and I had to go to the hospital once and it was totally worth it. But the thing is,
but you ended up making money on that deal.
I made money on that deal. Yeah. But that's because I had supplemental insurance, yeah, which is totally. A whole other story. But the thing is, honestly, what I can say for like 90% of the people out there, the best way to go is to not even worry about the deductible and just find an insurance plan that gives you good deals on going to the doctor and getting prescriptions.
Yeah.
Because I found something for $310.
Mm-hmm. Is it for you, your family?
Just for me. Just for me.
$300 just for you?
Yeah. Well, I was on Cigna. It was $285 a month. And this is where they get you.
So expensive.
This is where they get you.
Because when I was looking at Blue Cross Blue Shield, it was only like maybe $360 for both me and my kid.
That's before Obamacare. It's all
jacked up. No, it was $300 before Obamacare. Now it's like, it was like $360, $380.
Well, it just depends on what it is. It was $285. Here's the thing about Obamacare, and here's how the insurance company got me. And this is my suggestion. If you're happy with your insurance and it's time to kind of start over for the next year, go through the process again. Don't stick with your insurance, because here's what happened to me, and I guarantee you that they'll do it to you too. $285 a month is what I was paying for really good insurance.
For yourself?
Just for myself. And it was open enrollment. I said, I like my plan. They said, if you like your plan, you can just don't do anything. Just don't get on there. Just don't do a thing. We'll just keep charging you. As soon as open enrollment closed, they sent me a thing saying, oh, your insurance is going up $100 a month, by the way. Mm-hmm. And now there's literally nothing you can do about it, and screw you.
Yep.
So it's very important, like, even find the same plan and just resubscribe to it, because that locks in the number. Mm-hmm. Now, what I did is I found some really good plans that were like $20 for a doctor's visit, or $35, and pretty cheap prescriptions. But I found one for like a buck more. That was $0 copay before deductible, and $0 prescriptions before deductible. So I will literally pay nothing except if I have to go to the hospital.
Hmm.
The other thing you got to look out for that I noticed is that...
Well, you're going to have to bring down these stressful days that you've been having.
Right. The thing about a lot of them is that they have this whole out-of-network hospital stay. Not emergency care, mm-hmm. but like out-of-network hospitals and surgery and stuff. So say you have to have a certain surgery, or you have to go to you're in an ambulance and you go to a hospital and you realize they're not in your network. Well, in that moment, you're not going to tell the ambulance to take you somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So a lot of them say, yeah, it's covered, except you still have to pay 40% of the bill even after deductible. So if you have like $1 million bill, you still got to pay 40% of that. You know, I would rather not have insurance and then just declare bankruptcy in the end.
Yeah.
You know, so I found one that actually had out-of-network hospitals are also covered after deductible.
Wow, that's cool. How much was your deductible?
It's like $3,200, and honestly, I don't remember because I don't care.
$3,200 isn't a bad deductible. I mean, if you're, well, that's really not too bad.
But
I mean, my deductible right now is $2,000.
But like we were talking about last week, when you're a contractor and mm-hmm. you're getting 1099s left and right, and you're trying to find expenses so that you don't have to pay all of that extra tax in there. That's a mm-hmm. good thing to have. I know it's $300 and something a month, but honestly, let's be honest. Any of the Obamacare bronze plans are just garbage. It's just horrible. You're going to want at least a silver plan.
Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah. And I don't know a lot about it, but that's what I do know about it so far. It's confusing for many.
Yeah. Well,
tell me about 3D Max.
Okay, well, hold on. Real quick,
mm-hmm.
I want to give a special shout out to Wave Apps. We gave them huge tons of props last week, and I kept on saying that I was going to try and get them to be a sponsor or whatever. And so I ended up emailing them and emailing Otoy as well, seeing if they wanted to sponsor our show. Both of them came back and said that they didn't have any advertising budget. Otoy said they wish us the best, but Wave Apps really went above and beyond for us. And in my opinion, I mean, they not only got back to me like super fast, but they were like way cool. They're like, yeah, well, you know what? We don't have any advertising budget, but we sent around the podcast to everyone in our office, and we're all totally excited about it. They tweeted us. Yeah, they tweeted at us, which was so cool because we got a few followers from it, and like, you know, we had people tweeting about us, which was awesome. You know, it feels really good. And, you know, anyway, and they're going to send us some socks, which is way cool.
Heck yeah, I want me some socks. Way back.
So,
socks.
You know, and that to me, if you're a freelancer or a contractor or whatever, customer service, we've talked about this before, is like number one. You know, keeping those clients coming back, and really Wave Apps, in my opinion, went above and beyond, you know, just the standard customer service, you know, the standard customer service that anyone would send you. But they did a really mm-hmm. great job.
And they asked us to write something too.
Yeah, no, they asked if they could do a thing for us, like...
Well, yeah, but we're supposed to send them a quote or something. Yeah, I think they're going to post something.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. So shout out to Wave Apps. Way cool, guys. They're not sponsoring our show, but you know what? We'll give them all the props as possible that we can, because they're a really great company.
Yeah.
I also am supposed to declare my undying love for my wife. That was in my show notes that I had to do. Good, so good. There's that. I love her very much.
And now tell me about 3D Max.
3DS Max. Okay, so I finally got Windows 7 installed. Mm-hmm. Super excited about it. And I got 3DS Max. So I was a student, you know, I was a student forever. And I went back to school, and so I had a student email address. So I signed up with Autodesk. If you've got a student account or a student email address, you can sign up with the student version of just about any of their software.
Oh, nice.
And what's great is they give you free license for it. I mean, you can't use it commercially. That's the thing. You cannot use it commercially. There are no limitations on it at all, but you're not supposed to use it commercially, which
is
fine.
And you were just wanting to try it out, right?
Yeah, and that's the thing. I really just wanted to learn it. Because in our industry, you know, that's the thing. Like, 3DS Max, in this is just my opinion, 3DS Max and V-Ray is kind of the industry standard when you're doing interior renderings and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's just the way that I have seen it go when I'm looking up like stuff online, or I'm looking up models online and stuff. It always seems to have 3DS Max with V-Ray. So, I wanted to learn 3DS Max, so I signed up, you know, and I was able to get the newest version because I had the student version, which is great. You know, it's a three-year license for it, which is awesome, and they give you the newest version. So if you're a student, I totally recommend this, because you can get Maya, you can get AutoCAD, you can get basically the entire slew of everything they have. You can even get Smoke. How crazy is that?
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So... I got 3DS Max installed, and I knew nothing about it, so I went on lynda.com. My company has a lynda.com account, and I spent like 2 days just going through the entire basic beginners thing of 3DS Max, and I'll tell you, a lot of the stuff I already knew because it was just basic, you know, box modeling and stuff like that, or how to create a spline, or whatever, you know?
Just before I forget, did you know that if you're a resident of Los Angeles, you can get anything on lynda.com for free?
I did not know that. Why is that?
Because they have a deal with Los Angeles that it's part of a library thing. So if you have a valid LA library card, being a resident of LA, then you can get a login for Lynda for life and view anything on there for free.
That is crazy.
Yeah. So anybody listening, if you're LA, in LA, go check that out. I wish I remember where that link was. I think it was on Reddit Cinema 4D.
Interesting.
Yeah. Anyway, keep going. Sorry.
That's a really cool idea. Or that's a really cool thing. So, Lynda was really cool. You know, it's the first time I ever used it to learn something, and I liked it. So I've gone through like probably 10 hours worth of learning about 3DS Max, and I really haven't done that. I haven't like played around with it. I'm literally just watching it, and there are quite a few things that I really like about it. As someone who's going from Cinema, or I think from 3DS Max to Cinema, there's a lot of similarities that I've found in comparison to like Maya. Maya, I think, is just, in my opinion, just a whole nother beast. You know,
it's another language, man.
It is. Yeah. It's really hard on some of the stuff. It's hard to wrap your head around.
It's counterintuitive.
Like, I don't know. Like the hardest thing that I had that I found with Maya versus like Cinema 4D and 3DS Max is this whole kind of layer system. It's not the layers panel or whatever, right, but how you've got the layering where you can group stuff together, or in Cinema 4D, you put it into a null, you know, and I really like that. That's my favorite thing about the two programs versus, say, Maya. Maya, I just, and maybe I was doing it wrong in Maya. I don't know. But I couldn't get that part figured out. It never made sense to me.
Well, you were taking classes on Maya. You must have known a little bit how to do it.
Yeah, but I didn't, like, it wasn't, I was using what I was learning in Maya and converting it over to Cinema 4D, you know, because it was just a basic modeling class, and I had never really done any box modeling or anything like that in Cinema 4D. It was all just logos, you know, and so once I learned how to do the modeling through Maya, I wasn't very good. I was actually absent on the day that they started going into materials and metal ray. So I just was like, oh, whatever, you know? So, but I haven't gotten to, that's the one thing that I haven't gotten to on 3DS Max is the materials part and metal ray. And once we get into that, like, I feel like I'm going to have a really good understanding of 3DS Max. But a couple of the big features that I really liked, there's a thing called the object paint tools, you know, which is like almost exactly like Carbon Scatter. You can select the objects that you want to paint on, and you can just paint it right on, which is way cool. And then the welding options, like some of these like little options that they have in 3DS Max where it's you can set like a distance or almost like a threshold, you know, like with welding, for example. You can do this with Optimize in Cinema 4D where you kind of set a distance and it'll kind of put the two together. But I really like that in a lot of options in 3DS Max is it gives you the option, and it give you a preview of what it looks like before you actually choose whether or not you want to do it, which is way cool, in my opinion, because you can actually, you know, you don't have to commit to any changes, and you can see how it messes up your entire thing or something, you know, which is really neat. And then another one was the link controller. I don't know. I don't know if this is possible in Cinema 4D, because maybe it's just something that I've never had to deal with before, but you've got all these different controllers in 3DS Max that allow you to kind of do some complex things. And there's this one called, and I think you would have to actually go through Espresso in order to do this in Cinema 4D. I could be wrong. But there's a controller called the Link Controller, where basically at one point, I always wondered when I'm watching, like, you know, cartoons or something like that, how they get it to where someone like reaches out and grabs something and then it sticks to their hand and it just follows along with it. I was like, are they going to have to, you know, motion track everything? Well, they've got this thing called the Link Controller where basically you keyframe the point in which, you know, that object connects to another object, and then it just follows it all the way until you connect it to another object, which you can connect it. First, you connect it to the world, and then as soon as the person touches that object, you can then link it to the hand, you know, or whatever. And then at a certain point, if you want it to drop, you link it back to the world. It's really cool. It's very, very cool.
I see. I wonder if. I mean, it sounds similar to like doing a set driver. I mean, that is Espresso stuff, but
yeah,
like if you could keyframe a set driver, I don't even know if that's possible. I haven't thought about it before.
But it was, there's a few things in 3DS Max that I really like, you know, and I was so worried going into it that I was just going to be so lost, because Maya is so confusing. It's so confusing and it's so in depth. But I mean, it's the industry.
No, it's not bad.
I mean, it's the industry standard when it comes to doing like
architecture.
No, Maya.
Oh, Maya.
Yeah. Maya is so confusing, and you know, but it's the industry standard when it comes to like, you know, kind of producing 3D animations, and, you know, or yeah, stuff like that. I mean, that's what all the big dogs are using. But you know, 3DS Max is surprisingly easy. you know? And surprisingly, it going from a Cinema 4D background over to 3ds Max, I really liked it. The modifier list, you know, it's just basically like deformers and stuff like that. And the one thing that Dave and I always heard at the job that we were working at, they're like, oh, 3ds Max is so much better because you don't have to collapse your, you know, or make your stuff editable, you know, which is a total and utter lie. Absolutely. As soon as I was going through these tutorials and stuff, they're like, oh yeah, and here you're going to want to save a, you know, copy of your scene, because then you're going to have to, it's called converting to poly, you know, or converting to NURBS. They call it NURBS, not NURBS. I don't get it. I don't know which one is right. So
is that something slightly different? That's got to be something slightly different.
NURMS, NURBS.
I mean, I know there's NURB stuff in Max, or there was when I did it, because I was a Max person before, way back in the day before I was a Cinema person.
Yeah.
That's actually why I accidentally always called deformers modifiers, and I've probably said it in some tutorials before.
That's funny.
So you can tell, like, I'll be like, oh yeah, just add this modifier, and then I'll be editing, and I'm like, oh, dang it.
That's really funny. No, I didn't notice that. But that's one thing that I really like about 3ds Max is the modifiers and stuff like that, you know, and you can like layer on the modifiers one after the next and, you know, go back to one of the previous modifiers. It's pretty cool.
Cool.
Once I start getting into the I'm really excited because I know V-Ray in Cinema 4D I've had to open projects in V-Ray for 3ds Max to try and exactly replicate what I'm doing in V-Ray 3ds or what they're doing in 3ds Max and replicate it in Cinema 4D. So I kind of have a good general understanding that it is very similar, and I'm kind of excited because I know V-Ray for Cinema 4D that I'm really going to be able to do V-Ray for Max easily. So maybe I'll be doing some 3ds Max tutorials here in the future. Yeah, it would be cool. I'd be really excited about it, you know. So I don't know, maybe, but I'm really excited to be, you know, here's the thing. I don't want to be stagnant, you know. I want to be always be learning. So that's why I picked it up. I may never use it, but hey, at least it's another tool in my toolbox.
That's even why I'm trying to get more into like Unreal Engine stuff.
Yeah. And you know,
VR and all that.
So I took Monday off, you know, from work. I wanted to just have a day where I could just do stuff, you know, just finally get stuff installed and get everything else taken care of that I needed to. So I took Monday off. And I was going through and I was doing logos and I was, you know, getting stuff done and creating some websites and stuff like that. And so I'm like, oh, I really need to do this. So I start looking online and I'm looking at all these demo reels and stuff like that. And so I ran across a company here in Dallas. They're called Already Been Chewed. They had done some more, they presented it the last NAB. So you guys can go on to the Cinema 4D, you know, live or whatever, C4D live, and check out NAB. You can see their presentation.
You'd probably recognize the one, I think it's in Maxon's demo reel, actually. It's got the skateboarder guy kind of going down a waterfall of stairs or something. I don't remember exactly what it is.
Yeah, it's stairs, and then what's weird to me on that is that they've got water going down it, but the water doesn't have any texture to it. I don't know. I've always thought that was weird.
But they're, anyway, I didn't realize, like, I know who they are. I never realized they were Dallas-based.
Yeah, I know.
I thought I knew all the artists in Dallas, honestly.
Their company is like based in where I grew up, which is crazy to me. So like this small little, well, it was small, now it's gigantic.
Where?
I hate it. Allen.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, anyway. I'm surprised that like I've actually never talked to them or run into them or anything before, because, you know, Dallas doesn't have a lot of Cinema 4D guys or motion graphics guys for that matter.
Yeah.
Not 3D motion graphics guys.
Yeah, I don't know. So anyway, I start watching their stuff and man, I got so depressed. I just got so depressed because their stuff is so good. It's so good. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, I was like, okay, well, I'm going to learn 3ds Max this week. Oh, but man, I want to learn this and I want to learn that. And I want to do this and I want to do that. Oh, I've got so, and I was super depressed today because like, it's like, I cannot do the things that I want. I've got a plugin that I want to write. And so I've actually spent the last day or so, not really the last day. I've spent a few hours today looking into After Effects plugins and creating plugins because, talk about business of BroGraph. You know, that's where I find a lot of these tutorial companies are making their money, you know, and maybe this is mm-hmm. something that we don't want to talk about on the show, but I mean, it's the reality of life. I mean, do we want to, yes, eventually we want to make some money, but I also want to put some cool stuff out there that you guys would like, you know?
Right.
So I've got a couple plugins in mind, but it's like Grayscale Gorilla has X particles, right? They do X particles. Am I wrong?
No, they sell X particles. They don't make it.
Okay. I thought they did.
No, they sell it.
Okay. Well, they sell it, so they make money off of it. They've also got their texture packs and CityKit, you know, that they mm-hmm. do. Video Copilot has, a ton of stuff. You know, Andrew Kramer's working for Bad Robot.
I think I had heard that.
Yeah, he's working for Bad Robot, which is cool. You know, maybe mm-hmm. that's why J.J. Abrams is putting so many lens flares in all of his stuff.
Well, you know, there's on that lens flare package, there's actually something called the J.J. or something.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
That's funny. That's really funny. So, I mean, yeah, he's got optical flares. He's got 3D Element. He's got all this other stuff, you know, that it's just like he's selling crazy amounts of stuff on that. So, you know, and that's really what I'd love to do. I'd love to be able to do BroGraph full time, you know, and but I just don't have the skills to program. And that's super depressing to me.
I'm the same way. And programming is just, ugh.
And the thing is, like, I can program it as an expression, and that's not a problem. But right. I want to create something a bit more polished. You know, I want to make it an actual plugin that someone goes into the effects panel and clicks on it. And I've even got the way it lays out in my head, you know?
What do you have to know for that? Python?
No, it's C++, which I kind of know C++, but they've got the SDK in there. And you go into the SDK, and man, it's all just a foreign language to me. Like, you know, I don't look at it anymore. I just see blonde, redhead, brunette.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I look at it and I see, okay, yes, it takes me a while to break it down. I'm like, okay, there's your variable. Okay, here's your program, blah, blah, blah. But I have a hard time deciphering everything. It's like once it all gets thown at me at once, I kind of lose my mind, you know? I have to spend so much time focusing on what each little thing does before I truly really understand it. You know, HTML is kind of that way with me too. You know, mm-hmm. basically any code, as soon as I see it right away, it's like, okay, this just looks like a bunch of gerbil. It looks like a bunch of gerbils.
Well, you know, that's one of the things where you can do like Nick Campbell does, and you just hire people to do certain things, and there you go.
Yeah,
you
but know, do we have the money for that?
I mean, well, not yet. Not yet. We got to keep putting out tutorials and then start with a texture pack and start with some model packs that we're working on now anyway, and, you know, get there eventually.
Yeah, I know. It's just
got to wait it out.
There's so much stuff that I want to do, and there's so much cool stuff that I want to do for you guys, you know? Never enough time.
There's no time.
If only I had $1 million, didn't need a job.
Right.
Man, you guys would get so much out of me if I didn't have a job.
What's this Storybots thing you have written down?
Oh, my gosh. Okay, Storybots. So I'm you know, hanging out with my kid this weekend. While trying to work, and so he keeps on coming up to me, you know, oh, let's play Abby, you know, because there's this there's a Sesame Street game that he likes to play, or, you know, he's like, oh, Pumpkins or Scarecrow or something like that, because they're the YouTube videos, so I'm trying to watch something different, you know, something that I can enjoy as well. So I run across this little thing called Storybots. And there's this whole big, long, you know, they've got so many videos. And I was incredibly impressed with how good the production value is. And they are little 3D animated robots and they're made to look like claymation. And so, like, the whole time I'm watching this, I'm trying to break down all their animation, you know, techniques and how they get it to look the way it does. And, you know, so If you got a chance, just look up Storybots, you know, on YouTube. It's, they're these cute little, you know, kids nursery rhymes and stuff like that. But the animation style, like, they've got some great designers working for them. You know, it's so great when you can, and it goes back, in my opinion, to kind of learning your basic design principles. If you learn your basic design principles, and you can help, it will help you create a prettier picture and help you in turn create a better result of a video. And I really think that the people that they've got who are doing these videos just have these design principles down just amazingly, because the design on them are great. Mm. And it's so cool because they're 3D animated stuff that looks like claymation, you know? And right. They do a really good job making it look like claymation.
I'm going to have to check that out. I'll put that in the show notes too.
You should. So the one that my kid loves is the, you know, five little story bots jumping on the bed. It's the, you know, the monkeys one. But my favorite one is the alphabet, the ABC one. It's so good. So good. So, story bots.
Cool.
Yep.
And how about the Slack channel for motion graphics? Have you checked that out?
No, I haven't. You were saying it's like crazy. Like,
there's a lot of people in there.
Yeah.
It's like weird. Everybody that was on MoGraph.net back in the day when it was like at its peak popularity, like in 04, 05, maybe a little after that, they have all moved to this Slack channel. And there's all these different channels, water cooler and reels and just all this stuff. So I just thought I'd throw that out there. I didn't think I had talked about it before, but
yeah, you'd mentioned it. I don't know if you'd mentioned it on the show. I know. I mean, because you and I talk like for like an hour before every show, and then like an hour after every show. So I didn't know if you had mentioned it before or after or during the show, but yeah.
And in Octane news, this is crazy.
Yeah, I sent this one to you.
John Stewart and Octane. Or no, Otoy, at least.
Otoy, yeah.
But I guess it's not Octane. Maybe it's one of their other ventures. But so Jon Stewart's going to do this series of shorts or whatever for HBO. And that's kind of cool in itself. But the first thing that he's going to do is in conjunction with Otoy.
Yeah, which is crazy.
I'm like, what could he be doing with Otoy?
Yeah. And Otoy of all companies. Right. You know, it's like... like, you could see, oh, yeah, he's doing something for HBO and he's working with some other production company. But specifically working with Otoy, that is crazy interesting to me.
Well, I think it's online only, number one.
I mean, if it's... so, now, here's the thing. If it's online only, it's got to be something like with the VR stuff.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah,
well, not even necessarily VR, but, you know, they've come up with these ways to do the light fields and the light, whatever you call them, like... and the holographic stuff and all that. And I am wondering if they're somehow finding a way to do an HBO app where you can move the camera around or something, like through the scene that he's interviewing people in or whatever he's doing.
I don't think he's going to go back to the same interview style stuff.
Or whatever, you know, he's doing.
I think Jon Stewart has gone on to bigger and greater things, you know, and I really think that it has something to do, not him in particular that did this, but did you ever see the VR video about the earthquake in Nepal?
No, I didn't.
You should watch it. It's pretty intense. And so, like,
you saw it in VR?
No, I saw it. Well, it was a VR video. And so you were able to watch it in your browser, but you were also able to move your mouse around and go 360 degrees, or you could also connect your Oculus to it. I didn't have an Oculus. You know,
And YouTube decided they're releasing this now. Cardboard, which I bought a Cardboard last week, by the way. It's pretty cool.
Did you
cool.
really? That's
yeah,
funny.
It's great. You can put your iPhone in it or whatever. Uh-huh. But they're releasing all the YouTube stuff. So anything that has 360 control... well, I think like any video can, but it's not going to be 360. But you know, there is the ability to do 360 video in YouTube. I think it's going to be like the next level. Like now, you can watch any 360 video in Cardboard.
Yeah, That's really cool.
You know, Octane does the light field stuff. They also do...
Well, this is what I was going to say. The Nepal video, you know, it was kind of like... It kind of put the name out there, I think, for not only the person who did the video, but also, like, being able to show that this is a medium that people can use in order to create these cool, like, emotional videos and stuff, because it's crazy. Like completely, you know, being able to look all the way around at all this destruction and, like, sadness and stuff like that. And, you know, it's very emotional. And I think that's something, I think that's what Jon Stewart's going to do. I think he's going to do something along the lines of one of these causes that he's gotten behind, whether it be, you know, the animal sanctuary that he's creating at his place, or whether it be, you know, trying to help the 9/11 cancer people, which is just crazy to me, you know, that.
Yeah.
But, or even like, he even left the Daily Show for a little bit to do a documentary or something. I mean, he's got bigger stuff.
I'm wondering, you know, what it is, and if that's why Octane 3 is so delayed, because they've been working on this deal or whatever.
Yeah. And that's what, yeah, you had mentioned that to me the other day. I bet you anything you're totally right on that. You know, Octane 3 should have been out already.
And they're not saying anything, man.
I know. Shut up and take my money.
Right. You know? I mean, even in the forums, people are talking about it. But I know they're working on it. You know, when I was working on the that new beta test of Octane and messing with that, he was talking about what is coming in 3. So, you know...
Yeah, and they said it was Q3. Are we in Q4 already? We're in Q4, right?
Oh, yeah, we're in Q4.
Whatever. So. Okay.
So should we go to the artist of the week?
Let's do it.
Oh, yeah. Hey, before we do that real quick, I will also put a link to Litro, which is that thing I sent you.
Yeah, that I'm glad you talked about that, because that looks cool.
That crazy camera that can just, you just put it in a room and... Then you can just move the camera anywhere in the room afterwards.
Yeah, it basically sees the light and, you know, how intense and the color and...
Refraction.
Yeah, it's not like a camera. It's not a whole bunch of cameras. It's like a whole bunch of light sensors or something, which is cool.
It's basically what I figure we're going to eventually, you know, especially with this, like the vector stuff we were talking about last week and everything. You don't have to even use a camera in the future. You just put a device in a room and act out a scene or do whatever, and then you set up the camera moves later.
Totally. You know? it's kind of like Octane and V-Ray in a way, you know, because you've got the like, or the standard renderer in Octane, because Octane is seeing in real world lights, you know, and how things bounce and blah, 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 versus standard renderer, which is like points, you know, points from the camera and stuff like that. It's almost bitmap versus, I don't know if I said that correct.
So, yeah, I got the link in there. It's great and pretty, I mean, it's still bulky, like there's a server and all this, but you're going to be able to rent it, I guess. And I don't know, it's going to be a good one to watch. But our artist of the week, I hope I pronounced this correctly, Johannes Mattsson.
That sounds right.
Okay.
And Johannes.
He is, what country was he in? I don't remember. I'll have to go back and look, but
I'll open up the link and see if I can find it while you're talking.
So he put out a new reel, and it's just a beautiful looking reel. So we're featuring him as the artist of the week, and so we did a Q&A, and got back some info. So I'm going to go ahead and read it here. The first question is: where do you work, or are you a freelancer, and do you like it? Does being an employee or contractive have advantages, disadvantages to being one or the other?
He's in Amsterdam.
Amsterdam. Okay. Yeah.
And check out his, you know what, if you guys are watch his show real quick before, you know, listen to this next little bit or
unless
whatever.
You're in the car, don't,
unless
don't
you're in
watch
the car,
it in
then
the car.
Don't, you know, unless you want to kill people, but watch it, or watch it while we're talking to him. It's a really good reel. It's a really good example of an excellent reel. Go ahead.
So the answer is, I've gone a bit back and forth between being employed and freelance. Right now I'm doing the latter. I think that the obvious perk for being your own man is that you can choose clients and projects in a whole different way. The freedom to say no to something, basically. I'm also interested in the business side of things, and I'd like to start my own studio someday, so this is good training. And I think there's a lot of value in the continuity of being employed and that you can grow as a team and inspire each other, but I think I haven't found the right place for me to do that just yet.
Yeah, that's really cool. That's a really good, you know, because have you ever seen the oatmeal, that comic where you're working at home and you just become, you know, I think about that a lot anytime I think about maybe going out and freelancing by myself, you know, but you definitely learn a lot as a team, working as a team. And, you know, sometimes it's not the best thing. Sometimes you don't like it so much. I got in a fight with one of my Photoshop guys the other day, you know, and it's like, it happens in a team, but you can also learn so much from them.
Yeah. What's the oatmeal comic? I thought...
It's like the steps whenever you're, hold on, let me find it, freelancing. He talks about like working at home is both awesome and horrible, you know, because you basically, what is the one?
Is it the one about like stuff you're supposed to do today? You're still in your underwear?
Yeah, something like, oh no, it's a degradation of social skills.
Oh, okay.
You know, in 1 month, it's like, hey man, where you been? Haven't seen you around. Oh, I started working at home about a month ago. Been sort of cooped up. Then 1 year later, hey man, where you been? Haven't seen you around. He's in his underwear, pissing himself, going, hooba porkin' choppy her peepee, I peepee now. Like, okay.
Man, one of the things you got to do if you work at home is you got to get up and have that routine as if you're going to work.
Yeah.
Put on clothes. Don't sit in your underwear. You
know, Monday, I told myself I was going to treat Monday, even though I took it off from work, I was going to treat Monday like I was working from home day. Right. You know, but here's the cool thing. I didn't have an hour drive to work.
Right.
So I took my kid to daycare at the same time as I normally would. And then I went to the gym for an hour.
Oh, yes.
Which was awesome. And I got home like at 8:30, which is like basically the same time as I would have been to work.
Mm-hmm. And you've done all that. You've had like half a day before you even start your day.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's pretty sweet.
All right. So next question. What render engines do you use? Standard, Octane, V-Ray, etc.? The answer is I'm using the built-in physical engine, but I began tinkering with the Octane demo last week, and I think I'll buy it very soon. Really liking it so far.
Yeah.
If you watch the intro, that was my question, if any of that was done in Octane. It didn't look like Octane, but I thought maybe it was maybe another render engine.
Mm-hmm. Like maybe Maxwell or something like that.
And what was your process for building? Was it linear, nonlinear? In other words, did you go back and forth between the compositing program or did you wait till the end? And the answer is my process for my project are almost always linear. With clients, it obviously goes back and forth a bit because of feedback. But with my own projects, I think the line is pretty straight from start to finish. This intro started as a sketch, which turned into a model, which turned into a red character, which turned into the final animation. So not too exciting, I guess. For me, it's really important that my personal projects don't drag out for too long because then there's a big chance I won't finish it. Yeah. I have too many 80% done projects lying around my hard drive. Oh, man. Story of my life.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. And I'm actually surprised about the linear thing.
Why is that?
You know, because like when I go back and forth, I'm in After Effects and Cinema like back and forth a lot.
Yeah.
Before I get down to my render.
See, not me. I'm linear like that. You know, I'll work in Cinema 4D and I don't even touch After Effects until I've hit render.
There's so much dependent on, you know, in After Effects later that's dependent on what you do in Cinema 4D at a certain time, like this car project I was talking about yesterday. Yeah, I mean, with the car one
that you're doing, but you're, because you're...
I'm testing.
You know, you're testing and motion tracking stuff in. So, you'd do that. I would have done the basic garbage mat like you did, you know, throw it in there and that's it.
Mm.
I don't know. You probably, I mean, there was a lot to do with that.
It was complicated.
Yeah.
Let's see. Did you use any scripts or Espresso or was it all keyframes by hand? He says, I don't usually use scripts. I haven't gotten into that part of Cinema 4D yet, but I use a lot of Espresso in my rigs, mainly connecting objects with little math and so on. So I don't need to animate too many parameters. I'm a big fan of systems with as little keyframes as possible.
Yeah, same here.
What technique did you use for the clouds? The clouds are really great.
Yeah.
The clouds look awesome. The clouds are actually just clouds pictures with an alpha set up in a tunnel that the barrel can fall through. I did tests with Pyrocluster, but the render times weren't worth it. That's really cool. That's a cool idea.
Yeah. I mean, the clouds look really good.
Yeah. I like that. So you can kind of have the same clouds and they go around like foreground and background. What were your render times like? I'm not really sure, actually. We got a farm with 12-ish computers at my office, so I don't really consider render times at all anymore, but it's safe to say they weren't very long per frame, probably 4 to 8 minutes. Wow. Still, that's still up there.
Yeah, that is.
That's just because we're used to Octane now, I guess.
I know.
Okay, textures. These textures were great, and not just in the barrel and that little barrel thing, but like...
The ribbon that he's got going around the shield, oh man, yes. Sweet.
The shield, I think, is the first piece of work that's in the reel after that intro, and man, the textures are just phenomenal.
Yeah.
And that's why I asked, you know, how do you go about building your textures? Do you have a library? Do you use something like CG textures? And he said, I do use CG textures a lot, and I keep quite the library of different stuff. I'm a big fan of the Cinema 4D layer options in the material, which is great. Mm-hmm. So I use that quite a lot to layer things on top of each other. What percentage of time do you usually spend in post? He says, I'd say on a 2-week project, I spend 2 days in post for the most part of projects that are in my reel. So I guess around 20% of the time. Do you use any mocap when you animate characters, or is it all by hand? There's some character stuff in here that looks great too.
Yeah.
No mocap, all FK and IK animation. It can be a bit tedious at times, but I feel very rewarding.
The his little, like right after the cannon one, you know, that's got the pistons going in that the barrel thing. Man, that is sick. That looks good.
Your steam and fog effects are really good too. Do you custom build them with particles or use stock footage and comp into the scenes? He says it's a lot of stock, usually some particular thrown in there. Mm-hmm. I usually comp this kind of stuff with depth pass to fake a bit of realness. And actually, cool. I love the depth pass for any kind of comping. I almost never do any fog or so in the actual 3D scene. It's all AE magic, which is great. You want to do all that in post.
That is cool. I see is that an AIDS virus that he's got in there?
Some sort of virus.
I'm pretty sure it's AIDS.
No, I think it's just it's not AIDS in particular. I think it's just like a regular virus.
AIDS virus. I'm going to check.
I think a lot of viruses look like that though.
Do they?
Yeah.
I could be wrong. Why is my default search engine set to Yahoo?
Oh, you just installed uTorrent, didn't you?
I hope not.
You installed something that changed it.
It is not the AIDS virus. I take that back.
He said, I think that's it. Thanks a lot for reaching out to me, and I hope I could be of help on your podcast, and I'll make sure to listen in often. And we appreciate you taking the time to answer all those questions for us. I know it was pretty in-depth, but totally. This is a really good one.
Totally. Yeah, good reel. You should check it out. Now, if people have questions or they want to ask them stuff, they can email them, right?
Email. I'll put a link to the reel. I'm sure you could you know get in touch that way by going through Vimeo. But also, there's a thread in the Cinema 4D subreddit right now with the reel, and you know it's possible he may have already answered some of those questions in there. So
yeah, his email is hello@johannesm.com. johannesm.com.
You sure we're allowed to give that out?
Why not? It's on his main website.
Oh, okay then, yes.
Yeah, that's where I found it.
All right, cool. And then we had a couple questions that I...
It's even got his phone over here if you want that,
oh,
too.
Oh, geez. we had a couple questions online, as well as some others that we just won't even get to. I mean, I've got stuff coming in as we're doing the show. We got even more waiting for us at the inbox now. I don't know if you saw.
Oh, really?
Yeah. On Facebook.
That's cool.
One of them was a YouTube thing about render farm stuff, and I sent back an answer because, you know, I got to be honest right now. If you are looking into doing a render farm, and this person Marcelo actually was talking about, you know, already having like a Mac Pro and a couple laptops or whatever, but getting into something that was more hardcore, like you know, like a rack of processors or something. If you're looking to get to that point, you know, you're surprised. I'm going to recommend Octane because the entry level for it is just, it's nothing. And rather than spending all that time, man, what I am doing...
That's debatable.
Well, what I am doing right now with that project I've been talking about that that took 10 hours to render or whatever. Do you, I mean, you realize it would have taken 10 hours on the regular render engine if you had like a bank of 24 core i7s.
Yeah, totally. But, you know,
why spend all the money on that?
That's true. That's true. I mean, in comparison to buying a whole render farm. But here's the thing. I mean, I keep on going back to direct rendering versus PMC or path tracing, you know, like direct rendering is awesome. And that's the number one reason why you would want to buy Octane. But if you're doing some of the more, I don't know, like realistic glass, you know, that's what kills me just about every time is when I have to go to path tracing or PMC is glass on a cell phone.
I've done some crazy glass. I mean, all those bottles that I did in that one thing were all direct.
Yeah.
But you can do it. You got to figure out how to fake it.
Yeah, exactly. You do need to figure out how to fake it, you know, and direct lighting is really the best thing that comes with Octane, you know, and if you're going to be doing direct lighting, that option within Octane, then totally. Yeah. I mean, it is cheaper to buy a couple of really nice cards than it is to buy an entire render farm, you know, because two of those cards, what, they were like $600 each. So $1,200 versus spending, you know, well, $10,000.
Think about the power consumption thing too.
Absolutely.
You know, there's some people that have built render farms before and not just for this kind of thing, but for doing processing of like Bitcoin and stuff that end up getting raided because the authorities think that they started growing pot in their house.
Yeah, because their electricity is so high.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, well.
And not that that's a reason not to do it, but what I'm saying is your power, your electricity bill is going to be crazy too.
Yeah.
So take that into consideration in the costs, because that's definitely part of the cost.
Absolutely. So, I like my machine. I would not give up my machine for anything. You know, it's a sweet little monster Mac.
Man, it is such a workhorse. And I'm telling you, like, I was thinking about it today. You know, again, I've said it before, but I am powering three 23-inch cinema displays, a 24-inch Samsung display, and a 55-inch 4K Samsung.
You're ridiculous.
And while doing that, I was rendering a couple of those extra couple frames here and there in Octane, and then using the GPU, and then using the CPU to do stuff in After Effects. And
that's cool.
It didn't miss a beat.
Yeah. Now, you didn't have your priority set up to where it was still low, right? Like one of them was running low.
I always have one of them running low.
Yeah. That's cool. That's very cool.
But even so, I have so many displays that, you know, a couple of the displays are running off of the priority card. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
And that's cool, man. We also got a thing about Octane, a question that we were actually able to answer pretty easy, which is it was a thing about tiling, and that's something in Octane when, you know, within the texture itself, you have to take into consideration you're not turning off tiling on the tag itself. You're doing it within the texture.
Mm-hmm.
But it's sometimes
the image texture or whatever,
the border, and you say white or black or whatever for your border, and even if you do that, your other faces are going to also have stuff on them, so it's very important to have selection tags on your faces. Like if you're doing best, you know, like just like this case, if you're doing a cylinder and you want something on the top of that cylinder and it's there, you've done the borders correctly, but then it's still going to be around the sides of the cylinder because that's just the nature of UBW mapping, is it's kind of got like a separate map for the side. So you would have to mix down your geometry and then apply a selection tag to the top of the cylinder and then just put your base texture on the rest. We were able to help out in that situation, which was great.
Yeah, totally.
Oh man, that was a podcast. How about that?
It was. That definitely was a podcast. Yes, we did have a podcast.
Good show. Good show.
Yeah, it was. And I think we need to have Sean back more often.
For sure.
Because he was a good addition.
Yeah, man, let's get out of here. All right. Listen, cool. Next week, I will be out of town.
Oh, okay. On the weekend. I'm doing the podcast by myself then.
I think we can do it Monday night, though.
Okay, yeah, that's fine.
So we'll still do it, but it might be a day late.
Okay.
But not a dollar short. No. I'm going down to direct Spirit Fest.
Oh, yeah. Cheerleaders, right?
No. Spirit Fest.
Yeah. All the ghosts. It's the seance, right?
No. Spirit Fest.
Oh, right. All the drinking and stuff, like with all the booze.
No. Spirit.
I don't know what Spirit Fest is.
Spirit Fest. It's a festival of Christian bands.
Oh, okay. Oh, Spirit, right. Like, yeah. Like Jesus and stuff.
Yeah, like
okay.
The Jesus-y stuff.
That Jesus guy.
Yeah, guy. Actually doing two of them down in Corpus in Austin. 2-day thing, and I'll be coming back super early Monday morning. Monday night we can do a show, so.
Cool. Very cool. All right. Well, you guys make sure to check us out on Facebook or like us on or follow us on Twitter. If you guys have any questions, you can contact us at brographtoots@gmail.com.
Don't have that email address.
I know. We're going to get to it. Yeah. It's on the list. Add it to the list.
And rate us on iTunes and leave a review. We would love to get some reviews and ratings, please.
That is the biggest thing right now. Like, subscribe to the show. Whether you like us on Facebook or not, man, the iTunes stuff, please give us a rating. Please give us a review. You know, we would love to be able to get up higher in the ranks in iTunes.
Tell your friends about us and all that.
We really like doing this.
And subscribe to us, too, if you're not subscribed.
We got a few tweets about the podcast this week, so shout out to the couple of people who did that was very cool. You know, and all you guys, just if you can take 5 seconds and just tweet about us, you know, send people our way, or you know, to the podcast, or just review us on iTunes, that would be fantastic.
And of course you can check us out at brograph.com, and you can check out our tutorials there, and Brograph Talks will be the new one tomorrow. You can also get the No Brograph No Mograph t-shirt.
Yeah. And I started working on the new one.
I saw your thing.
It's four rendered out, four like old school film canisters. And I'm going to change the saying on it. It's going to say, like, which film do you use? Or no, it's... That was the old one, yeah. The new one's going to say, same camera, different film. That's what it was going to be. So,
okay, cool.
Yeah. And so I designed each of the old little, you know, 35 millimeter film canisters to look like, you know, Octane or V-Ray or physical renderer, whatever.
Cool.
I like it.
Subscribe to us on everything. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and of course YouTube, which is the main place that we're at. And now we are on Periscope. So that should be fun.
Yeah.
See how that goes.
Yep.
Love me some Periscope. So
cool.
All right. Well, everybody have a good one. And until next week, I'm Dave.
And I'm Matt.
Have a good one.
Later, bros.
It's pretty good, I guess. Brograph.com, an online resource for learning critical components of Cinema 4D and After Effects, specifically catered to help you prevail as a motion graphic designer.
What's up, bros? Welcome to another Brograph motion graphics tutorial.
We give you professional time-saving tips, shortcuts, and lessons that help give you an edge over your fellow designers. Not only this, but our new Brograph Talks help you in your file management, hardware configuration, and client relations.
I love projects that scare me. When our art director comes to us and asks for something that I had never done before, man, it gets me pumped.
Join us for live sessions, check out our crazy Cinema 4D experiments, or just watch our Fun with Brograph series, where we show you practical applications for techniques learned in previous tutorials. Do this from the beginning, and your client is going to respect that, and they're going to respect you, and they're going to respect your time. Subscribe today and get automatic updates on the latest tutorials, tricks, tips, and inspiration brought to you by industry professionals Dave Koss and Matt Milstead, all with a slight dash of dry humor peppered in.
Real nice banana.
Brograph.com, your source for tutorials that will help you thrive in the motion graphics industry. Don't just play around with Cinema 4D and After Effects, master it, and make money by becoming indispensable at your workplace.
We don't care how you get here, folks, just get here!
Subscribe now to Brograph Tutorials.
It's pretty good, I guess.